covered in flesh and blood, you came to us. Nothing of consequence to see. Inside of time and space, you lay.
I'm so excited about today's topic. Like Jason said last week, the attributes of God are a topic that I'm really passionate about. I mean, that's the point of this whole thing. It's the whole point of your life and my life is to know God. In Jeremiah chapter 9, that's God himself says that. He says, don't worry about your riches, don't worry about your wisdom or your strength. If any man should boast in anything, boast in the fact that you know me. He is our treasure. And so to be able to take time and reflect on who he is, that's always my favorite topic. The attributes of God, since 2013, there's a rumbling. Since 2013, the bulk of my personal study time with the Lord, my one-on-one time with the Lord, has been focused on the attributes of God. I love studying the attributes of God. I have a book that I've been working on the last couple years that's scheduled to be published this summer on the attributes of God. It's a topic that I absolutely love. That said, I'm even more excited that not only do I get to preach on the attributes today, but I get to preach on the holiness of God, an attribute that bleeds into all other attributes. God's holiness is what makes everything else about him unique. His love is a holy love. His power is a holy power. His presence is a holy presence. His holiness bleeds into everything else that he is. So to be able to preach on that this morning really, really excites me. That said, though it's a topic that I've been given to preach on, I don't plan on really preaching a topical sermon this morning. I plan on looking at a particular text. And because I feel like in the text, in our text today, it's Isaiah chapter 6, I feel like Isaiah does such a good job at illustrating God's holiness. In systematic theology, we break God's holiness down into two aspects. There's the relational aspect of his holiness and the moral aspect of his holiness. The relational aspect meaning that God is distinct, he's different, he's set apart. And the moral aspect being that he's completely pure, completely good. And I feel like Isaiah does such a good job in his text painting this picture for us that I don't need to dig through various texts and create a topical sermon. We can just look at what Isaiah has to say, break this down verse by verse, and really get a great understanding of who God is and the fact that he is holy, I think will become completely clear in this passage. So if you brought your Bible, or if you didn't, there should be one in the pew in front of you if you want to follow along with me. I'm going to read out of Isaiah chapter 6, starting at verse 1. I'll give you a second to get ready. All right, here we go. It was in the year King Uzziah died that I saw the Lord. He was sitting on a lofty throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Attending him were mighty seraphim, each having six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. They were calling out to each other, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of heaven's armies. The whole earth is filled with his glory." Their voices shook the temple to its foundations, and the entire building was filled with smoke. Then I said, "It's all over. I am doomed, for I am a sinful man. I have filthy lips, and I live among a people with filthy lips. Yet I have seen the King, the Lord of heaven's armies." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a burning coal he had taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. He touched my lips with it and said, "See, this coal has touched your lips. Now your guilt is removed and your sins are forgiven." Then I heard the Lord asking, "Whom should I send as a messenger to this people? Who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am, send me." This is a good text. This is a really good text. Can I leave this here? Is that okay? This is a really good text. So now we have Isaiah in the throne room of God. Now this opening phrase, he starts the entire passage off with that this is occurring in the year that King Uzziah died. Now the significance there, if you don't know who King Uzziah is, King Uzziah was crowned at 16 years old. He was crowned king. Now, if you ask any 16-year-old if they would be able to run a kingdom as king, chances are they're going to tell you yes. At 16, I'm sure I would have told you yes. But now, looking back, I can tell you with absolute certainty that at 16, I wasn't ready to rule a kingdom. Putting somebody who's 16 years old in charge of a kingdom probably isn't the best idea, but we're actually told in Scripture that King Uzziah was a great king. At 16 years old, it says he reigned for 50 years, and we're told by Scripture that he was actually a phenomenal king. King Uzziah, we're told, was faithful to God. He was faithful to the precepts of God. He feared God. And because of that, God gave him favor. God gave him great favor in battle. We're told that King Uzziah actually had a reputation all throughout the land. The Bible says all throughout the land, high and low, everybody knew King Uzziah to be a powerful warlord. They knew that God gave him favor in war, and so everybody knew, you don't mess with that guy, because if you go to battle with him, you're going to lose. He has God's favor. And so up to this point, King Uzziah had done things in terms of war and battle and had accomplished things that nobody else, no other king prior to him had ever done. He was hugely successful in terms of war and battle. So he brought power and protection to the kingdom. And then not only that, but the economy of the people was largely based on the agriculture. And he spent a lot of time and a lot of resources in developing that and broadening that. So he brought a lot of resource to the land as well. So not only do they have a lot of protection and power as a kingdom, but they also had a lot of prosperity. And there's a reason why Isaiah mentions all this, because it gives us some context into, one, the mind frame that Isaiah is coming into this vision with, as well as the mind frame of the people of Israel. And it also gives us some context into the motivation behind God now presenting himself to Isaiah at this time. You see, what happened was there was a huge spiritual decline in the kingdom because everybody had now focused their eyes on Uzziah. Through Uzziah, they had prosperity, they had protection, they had power, they had comfortability, and so they took their eyes off of God and they looked at Uzziah. And what ends up happening is Uzziah, though he was a great king for 50 years, Uzziah becomes prideful. He becomes arrogant in all that power and all that favor. And he decides that there's no longer any bounds for him. He steps outside of his bounds and he thinks that he's going to step into the high priest duties now. Now that's an office that God had designated to specific people, which did not include Uzziah. But Uzziah decided, you know what? There's no bounds for me. I'm King Uzziah. So I'm going to overstep my bounds and I'm going to try to occupy the office of high priest and fulfill the high priest duties. And he sins against God. God strikes him with leprosy. And he's quarantined for the rest of his life until he dies as a leper. It's a tragic death. All that's important, because Isaiah prefaces the entire vision with that. He says, look, at this time, this is when the kingdom was in a panic. Everybody was worried about, okay, the throne's open. The throne's occupied. The king that we had all this protection and prosperity under is no longer here. What if the next king, what if his son Jotham isn't as powerful, doesn't have the same favor? What if we don't have the same comfortability under him? And so everybody's kind of in a panic. And then we have God. Comes to Isaiah. Isaiah has this vision and he sees God in his throne room. The next thing he says he sees God on his throne. So the throne is not occupied. The throne is still occupied. It is not vacant. God is very much on his throne. So he's showing Isaiah the power and the prosperity that you had through Uzziah was not because of Uzziah. It was because of me. And oftentimes we do this. We absolutely do this. Where we have idols in our lives, things that bring us power, protection, prosperity, comfortability, and we put them on the throne. They take our attention. And sometimes God has to step in and remove that idol in order for us to take our eyes off of it and put our eyes back on him. Sometimes it requires him to step in because we don't do it ourselves. But we absolutely do what's taking place right here. But now that this has been removed, now that Uzziah has been dethroned, Isaiah is now seeing God. And he says he sees him on a throne, and not just any throne, he sees him on a throne, he says a lofty throne, a throne that is high and lifted up. This isn't a throne that's equal with other thrones. This is a throne that is high above all other thrones. This is the King of Kings. This is the Lord of Lords. He's describing the relational aspect of God's holiness. He's saying he's distinct, he is different, he is set apart. This is not just any king, this is the King of Kings. And then he takes it a step further. This is why I love this passage, because there's so much cultural context in here. Isaiah is really drawing such a beautiful picture of God's holiness, but he says, I seen God on his throne. It's a lofty throne. And then he says, and the train of his robe filled the entire temple. I want you to picture that real quick. Imagine God sitting up here. He's sitting on his throne, and the train of his robe is, just imagine it flowing over the top of the pews, wrapping around the walls, touching the roof. Just imagine it filled with his robe, the train of his robe. And the thought process here is this: in this culture, a king would have a longer train on his robe, because the thought in this culture was the longer your train, the harder it was to do manual labor. The harder the train, the less work you could do for yourself, therefore the more people you had working for you. So to say that God's on his throne and the train of his robe is filling the entire temple is to say that everyone is working on behalf of God. Everyone, whether they know it or not, whether they acknowledge it or not, you, me, everyone outside of here, whether they believe in God or not, everyone is working according to the will and pleasure of God. Everyone is subject to his rule. That's what Isaiah is saying here. It seems like kind of an abstract, weird picture, right? The train filling the robe, but that's the point that Isaiah is making. Again, it's the relational aspect of God's holiness. He is unlike anyone. He is the supreme being. He's not just the supreme being on a list of all other beings. He's on a completely different list in and of itself. The word perfect has to look up the word God in the dictionary to figure out how to define itself, because God alone defines that which is perfect. So then Isaiah, he moves on with his vision, or at least how he's describing it. And he says that God's sitting on his throne, the train of his robes filling the temple. And he says there are these beings, these seraphim. And what that means is that the seraph, in the Hebrew, seraph means serpent. It also means burning ones. You have this image of a serpent-like being who's synonymous with fire, and they have six wings. I digress here, but it kind of sounds like a dragon almost if you describe it, the way you describe it when you look at it in the Hebrew. But you have this serpent-type being with six wings who's synonymous with fire in the Hebrew, the seraph. And the im is the plural, right? So it's like me saying Bible or Bibles. Seraph and seraphim, it just means there's multiple, okay? So we have these creatures, these spiritual beings that are flying around the throne of God, and they're proclaiming, holy, holy, holy is God. Now he describes them as having six wings. The first two are covering their eyes. And what we're seeing here, and what I want you guys to really recognize here, is that what we're seeing here in the seraphim is what a true life of worship looks like. They've been tasked with sitting in the throne room and worshiping God. If there was anyone we can look at for an example on what worship looks like, it's the seraphim. And that's exactly what we're seeing. We're seeing what a true life of worship looks like. It says they cover their eyes. Now the seraph, I'm going to use the word angel because in our culture we kind of use that universally, but technically, biblically speaking, angel is a job description. It's not a type of being. Seraph are types of creatures. Cherubs are types of creatures in the spiritual realm that we see in Scripture. Angel is a job description, but in our culture we always say angel, so I'm going to use the word angel. Anytime you see an angel present themselves to a person in Scripture, for the most part, what happens? The person's terrified. Most of the time they fall on their knees and they're terrified, right? They're in shock. Now here are these creatures that so terrify us, and they wouldn't dare look upon God. They cover their eyes. They won't do it. They wouldn't dare look upon God. Now if you remember Moses, I love Moses because Moses was always, when you look at his interactions with God, he was always trying to get a little bit more. Always wanted a little bit more of God. He was always asking for more of a glimpse. He wanted to see his face. He wanted to, you know, have closer and more intimate fellowship with God, and was always practically begging for more. And one conversation he has with God, he says, can I please see your face? Please just let me see you. And this is amazing. God says to him, he says, well, no living creature can look upon my face and live. What? Think about that. No living creature can look upon my face and live. That's who you're praying to. That's who you're worshiping. We're talking about a being whose glory is so vast that you can't even look at him, you can't even look at his face without it being your destruction. So here we have these seraphim that are in the presence of God, and they're covering their eyes because they know, no matter how terrifying or intimidating they might be to us, it's nothing compared to how intimidating God is to them. They wouldn't dare look upon him. And then it says they cover their feet. Now in this culture, the feet were considered to be unclean. And it makes sense if you think about it. In the terrain that they're in, they're wearing sandals. It's the feet that collect the dust and the dirt, which is why it was a common social custom in this time to wash the feet of your guests when they came into your home, because they were considered unclean, collecting all kinds of dirt and dust. So you have the seraphim covering their feet while they're in the presence of God, because they wouldn't dare bring something unclean into the presence of God. Remember, again, with Moses, with the burning bush, if you recall, when Moses is approaching the burning bush, what does God say to him? He says, take off your shoes. Take off your shoes, Moses, for this is holy ground. God's holiness, his glory, is so vast that even the immediate area around him becomes purified and sanctified just because he's there. So he tells Moses, take off your shoes. This is holy ground. So you have these seraphim covering their feet because they wouldn't dare track anything unclean into the presence of God. So four of the six wings are used for being in a state of worship, recognizing the word worship comes from an old English word meaning worth-ship, to acknowledge one's worth. We're told by the Apostle Paul. In our culture, again, we say the word worship and typically we mean music, right? The proclamation of word. But Paul tells us in Romans chapter 12 that worship is more than just proclaiming God's worth in word, but also indeed our lives are a very act of worship, right? So you see four out of the six wings being used to be in a state of worship, two of which are being used to do something, right? They're being used to fly them around so that they can further proclaim the glory of God. We see an emphasis in being rather than doing, right? Four out of the six are for being in a state of worship. Only two are used for doing. We so often feel like, you know, we get saved. This is why Paul says, when he's talking about elders and deacons, this is why Paul says that an elder or deacon should never be a new believer, right? A new convert, because he says that, you know, arrogance, pride, things like that will settle in. But we often do this. Somebody new to the faith, and we all do this. As soon as we become Christians, the first thing we think of is, okay, how am I going to serve God? What am I going to do now? How can I serve the church? How can I serve my community? What can I do now? And we bypass the whole being aspect of Christianity. That's the core of Christianity, is being in relationship. Jesus, when he preaches on the Sermon on the Mount, he doesn't come out of the gate saying, okay, here's a list of all the things you need to do in order to follow me. He starts with the Beatitudes, the attitudes to be. He says you need to be meek, you need to be humble, you need to be poor in spirit. Be peacemakers. It's all about being. And then once you're in a state of being, once you have a contrite heart and you're poor in spirit and you're in a state of worship, then you can do. And so we see this in the seraphim. There's an emphasis in being rather than doing. Four out of the six are used simply for worshiping God. And then they start proclaiming, they're saying, holy, holy, holy is God. Now in the Hebrew language, anytime you see repetition to the second degree, right? When Jesus says, truly, truly, I tell you, repetition to the second degree like that in the Hebrew language is basically like sending somebody a text message in all caps and three exclamation points. You're saying, hey, you got to pay attention to what I'm saying here. What I'm saying is important. This needs emphasis. You can't miss this. In the Hebrew language, when you see repetition to the second degree, that's what that means. What we see here, though, and it's the only time we see this ever, what we see here is repetition to the third degree. Holy, holy, holy is God. R.C. Sproul, a phenomenal theologian, a hero of mine, when he passed away a couple years ago, I took the day off work just so I could see the live streaming of his funeral. He was an amazing man of God. he has a book called The Holiness of God, and he actually references that passage, and he makes a great point. He says, nowhere else in the scripture is any other attribute of God mentioned to the third degree, given emphasis to the third degree. At no point in scripture does anybody ever say love, love, love of God. Power, 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 wrath, 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 justice, justice, justice. You never see his immutability or his faithfulness or his goodness. You never see any of that ever proclaimed and given repetition to the third degree like you do his holiness. Scripture is really trying to drive home how important it is that we understand that God is holy. And here's why. Here's why we need to understand completely that God is holy. When Isaiah sees all of this, it says that he falls to his knees and he trembles and he says, woe is me, for I am undone. I'm a man of unclean lips and I come from a people of unclean lips. It's because he can see God's holiness, and in light of God's holiness, he's able to see the type of sinner he is. You see, we are still brand new in the faith until we come to a place where we realize the gravity of his holiness. Because until we understand the gravity of his holiness, you don't understand the gravity of your sinfulness. Isaiah is seeing the holiness of God, and he's realizing for the first time how wicked he is. He's in an all-white room with brand new white carpet, white walls, white ceiling, white furniture. Everything is so clean that it's radiating light. And he looks down and he realizes he's covered in mud. And he's lived his entire life rolling around in mud with pigs. It's all he knows. He's never realized that he's dirty until he came into this clean room. And so for the first time, he's realizing, wow, I'm filthy. And I've dragged all of this mud into this clean room. And the reaction that he has, the assumption that he makes is, if the room is so clean and so purified, then the homeowner must really love that which is clean and purified, and therefore must hate that which is dirty. And so he says, woe is me, I am undone. The assumption he comes to is, the homeowner is going to kill me. I just tracked all this mud in his house. Clearly, he loves that which is clean. He's come into the presence of God and he's seeing holiness and purity for the first time in the realest way. And he's recognizing the sin that he just tracked into this place. But God's response to him is amazing. We see this again in Luke chapter 5. I'm going to read that for you guys. In Luke chapter 5, we see a very similar interaction between Jesus and the apostle Peter, and the same thing happens. Chapter 5, verse 1, I'm going to go ahead and just read it. It says, one day as Jesus was preaching on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, great crowds pressed in on him to listen to the word of God. He noticed two empty boats on the water's edge, for the fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. Stepping into one of the boats, Jesus asked Simon, its owner, to push it out into the water. So he sat in the boat and taught the crowds from there. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, now go out where it is deeper and let down your nets to catch some fish. Master, remember that. Master, Simon replied, we worked hard all last night and didn't catch a thing, but if you say so, I'll let the nets down again. And this time, their nets were so full of fish, they began to tear. A shout for help brought their partners in the other boat, and soon both boats were filled with fish and on the verge of sinking. When Simon Peter realized what happened, he fell to his knees before Jesus and said, oh, Lord, what happened there? Why isn't he master anymore? Why is he Lord? Oh, Lord, please leave me. I'm too much of a sinner to be around you. For he was awestruck by the number of fish they had caught, as were the others with him. His partners, James and John, the sons of Zebedee, were also amazed. Jesus replied to Simon, don't be afraid. From now on, you'll be fishing for people. And as soon as they landed, they left everything and followed him. Peter goes into this event with Jesus, calling him master. We saw the first thing he called him was master. And the Greek word that he's using there is epistates, which means essentially wise teacher, master, teacher. So what he's saying to Jesus is, okay, wise teacher, I'll do what you said because I'm submitted under your teaching. Even though I spent all night doing this already and it didn't work. But then the miracle happens and Peter gets somewhat of a glimpse of the deity of Christ. He begins to realize, at least to some degree, that this is the holy God. And his response changes. He then uses the word Lord in English, but the Greek word that he uses is actually Kyrios. And Kyrios is actually a slave master. Kyrios doulos, doulos being the slave, Kyrios being the owner. He's essentially, he went from saying, you're a wise teacher, to saying, everything belongs to you. You're the one true living God. You're a king. I belong to you. My life is not my own. Which we see he not only said that, but he obviously believed that because the next thing he does is he gives everything up. Says he walked away from his entire business, left everything behind. His means for taking care of his family, he leaves it behind. Kyrios. But then what does Jesus say to him? He says the same thing to Isaiah. Do not fear. He comforts them and then he commissions them. He says to Isaiah, do not fear. And then he says, who's going to go out and talk to my people? Who's going to deliver this message to my people? And Isaiah says, send me, I'll go. Then he says to Peter, do not fear. He comforts him, then he commissions him. He says, you're no longer going to be a fisherman, you're going to be a fisherman of men. So what's taking place here? We see two different men in two different sections of Scripture, Old Testament and New Testament, who had some understanding of who God was going into these events. But it wasn't until they had a full recognition of the holiness of God that their sin became aware to them. What does Peter say to Jesus? I'm too sinful to be around you. It isn't until they saw the holiness of God that they recognized their sin. And the fact that God's response to both of them was, do not fear. He comforts them and then he commissions them is amazing, because that's how it works in all of our lives. We all come to a place, everybody that's in here, I'm assuming you've come to the place where you've confessed your sin just like the two of them have. You've acknowledged that you're a sinner just like they have. You've got to a place where your heart and your mind is in a state of worship. You're poor in spirit, you're meek. You've realized I need God. You've realized everything belongs to him. He is everything. I owe everything to him. I can't do anything without him. That's where these men are at. And it's when you get to that place when now God's able to use them. He comforts them. He commissions them. So I'm going to end with this. We've seen through Isaiah's passage just how distinct, how different, how set apart God is, how holy he is. And I believe we can have a very good grasp on that through just reading that passage. But I think just like Peter and Isaiah, the only way to truly understand to the fullest degree God's holiness is if he reveals that to you. Is if that relationship is there, if it's experienced. So usually when I preach and I end a sermon, I like to give people something to do, but I think the text today is telling us that we need to stop doing and we need to start being. And so I'm going to encourage you guys with this. Please, this week, hit the pause button. Hit the pause button. Whatever you can hit the pause button on, hit the pause button. Husbands, take your kids out to the park for 2 hours or the movies, whatever you got to do. Get the kids out of the house. Give your wife the opportunity to sit in her prayer closet on her knees and cry out to God. Open up her word. Read. Do what she's got to do. Have that alone time with God and acknowledge that he is holy, holy, holy. Wives, return the favor the next day. Husbands, get on your knees and cry out to God. Don't be so busy. The next day, sit your kids down with you, do it with them. However you got to go about it. But I want to encourage you guys this week, take the time. It's not just Sunday. Sunday's great, but it's not just Sunday. It doesn't end here. It doesn't begin here. It doesn't end here. The rest of the week, take time. I'm not saying you're not, but I'm encouraging you to continue to do so or to start if you're not. Take the time to get in God's presence. Cry out to him, Lord, show yourself to me. I'm reading your word. Make yourself evident to me. God, show me your holiness in a way that I've never seen it before. Make yourself known to me. I'm a sinner, and I need you. That's not just a conversation we have with him when we first become Christians. It's a conversation we need to have every day. So let's stop worrying about doing, and let's spend more time worrying about being. Let's pray.
Though I'm not entitled, still you call me your child. God, you don't need me, but somehow you